Hi everyone, my name is Larissa. I'm a neurobiologist and a person with Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease or CMT. In this video, I'm going to talk about a French company, Farnext, and the drug that they have been developing and testing for the last 15 years for CMT1A, known as PXT3003. In July 2024, it became clear that the drug is not going to be marketed and the company is basically going bankrupt. But how and why did that happen? Let's try to answer these questions, especially given that nobody else, even in the CMT world, seems to cover this big news. PXT3003 is a combination of three previously approved for other conditions drugs: baclofen, naltrexone, and sorbitol. When a drug which is already approved and tested for other conditions is tested for another disease, it's called drug repurposing. This approach often allows companies to skip the first step of testing the drug in humans, that is, phase one of clinical trials. So, as you can see in this picture, all the three repurposed components of PXT3003 are at much lower doses. The safety profile and the mechanisms of action for each of them are already known, somewhat. But how come these three components were chosen to be combined and tested for CMT1A? Well, Farnext used several databases and artificial intelligence, AI, to narrow down the compounds that could work in CMT1A. First, they analyzed molecular pathways that are involved in the disease development based on genome-wide association studies, GWAS. These studies identify which letters in the genome are associated with the disease pathogenesis. Then, Farnext chose compounds that could target the identified pathways. Initially, around 50 compounds were considered. Then, several combinations of compounds were tested in animal models of CMT1A. And finally, one combination, which I've already mentioned, baclofen, naltrexone, and sorbitol, showed effectiveness in animals and thus was tested in humans. By then, it was already known from previous studies what each of these compounds does. Baclofen is an agonist of GABA receptors, and it is described to negatively regulate the expression of PMP22 gene in Schwann cells, which is exactly what we want to achieve, because CMT1A is caused by duplication of PMP22 gene, which leads to a high production or expression of PMP22 protein. It is also known that baclofen acts as a muscle relaxant. Naltrexone is an opioid receptor antagonist and also may decrease the level of expression of PMP22. In addition, at low doses, naltrexone has an anti-inflammatory effect, which is also good for CMT1A. Sorbitol may act as a protein chaperone, meaning that it may stabilize misfolded proteins, which is a molecular feature of CMT1A. It is also known as a sugar substitute. Okay, so we know what each of these compounds does, more or less, but of course Farnext had to prove that the combination works in people and that it is more effective than each of the compounds separately. So, as you can see in this timeline that I made of PXT3003 clinical development, phase 2 clinical trial was launched in December 2010. Remember that Farnext could skip phase 1 because of the drug repurposing. And phase 2 study was performed in 6 sites in France in 80 patients aged 18 to 65 years old, suffering from mild to moderate CMT1A, and PXT3003 was given over 12 months. 3 doses of the combination were tested, and it was found to be safe and well tolerated in all 3 doses. So in 2014, the company reports encouraging efficacy data. Patients with CMT1A taking PXT3003 show improvement beyond stabilization. This was estimated using the Overall Neuropathy Limitation Scale, or NLS. It's a validated scale that measures functional disability. So in clinical trials, this is called endpoints.
an event or outcome that can be measured objectively to determine whether the intervention being studied is beneficial. This is actually very important. What researchers use to measure disease progression or improvement affects the interpretation of the results. So you imagine you want to measure whether your child's height has changed over the summer. You will use a device that measures the height, right? Such as a measuring tape. You will not use a scale or a thermometer for this purpose. But when it comes to clinical trials, it deciding what tool to use to measure the disease progression, it's not that simple. So ONLS might not be the best tool for CMT1A progression measuring. And researchers are actually working on developing other tools such as biomarkers. But anyway, for PXT3003 trials, ONLS was used as a primary endpoint. And encouraging results from the phase 2 study supported the initiation of the phase 3 trial. The phase 3 study was an international multicenter randomized double-blind placebo-controlled 15-month clinical trial. There were two doses that were tried in this trial, the highest dose used in the phase 2, and twice that dose of PXT3003, and it was compared to placebo. It was tested in 23 sites scattered throughout Europe, US, and Canada. There were 323 patients, same age, same disease progression over 15 months, and as I mentioned already, two doses were used. But then, unfortunately, this study had to stop prematurely in 2017. This happened due to an unexpected formulation issue occurring in the high dose group, or high dose arm, it's called also. Then in October 2018, Pharnext announced that analysis of the primary endpoint, ONLS, from the high dose arm suggested efficacy in humans. So this study also further demonstrated the safety and tolerability of PXT3003. Therefore, they launched another study, open label extension study, in which patients from the phase 3 trial continued treatment with PXT3003. Open label means that both patients and physicians know of the assigned treatment, whereas in double blind studies, none of them know. In other words, open label means that if you are a participant, you know if you are taking PXT3003 or placebo. Pharnext then combined the results of the abruptly stopped phase 3 trial and the open label extension trial and showed a good safety profile over long-term use and sustained efficacy of PXT3003 in CMT1A patients after 6 years of total trial time. Okay, so then a second phase 3 trial was launched in March 2021 to confirm the efficacy and safety of the combination. This trial was an international, multicenter, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled again. So this time there were 52 sites worldwide, 387 patients were involved, the same age, same disease progression, same duration as the first phase 3 trial, and again the same doses. Two doses were checked, plus placebo. Then, in December 2023, Pharnext announced that analysis of the primary endpoint, which is ONLS, as we remember, did not confirm findings from previous clinical trials. Uh-oh. So patients with mild to moderate CMT1A expected improvement in both treatment and placebo, rather than the slow deterioration, which is typical of CMT1A's natural progression. Other data suggest no deterioration in the condition of patients under treatment. So this is when I started getting worried, and I guess everybody who read the news on PXT3003 development started getting worried, because now it seemed like it is not obvious if the combination is beneficial, if it works. But Pharnext announced that they are waiting for the results from phase 3 trial led by Pfanex partner Tesly in China in 25 sites. So we waited again to finally get the very disappointing news in July 2024, last month. On their website, Pfanex announced that they are not going to publicize the results from the trial in China. They are no longer sustained financially and will request to start liquidation of the company, which means the company is ceasing to exist. So overall, that means that the drug failed. It is not going to be marketed and the company went bankrupt because PXT3003 was their main asset. They were developing a couple more drugs, which are also repurposed drugs for Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease, if I'm not mistaken. But anyway, CMT was their main asset. The question is, why did the drug fail? And is it really completely useless, right? Well, this is not necessarily true. Based on the results Pfanex presented in December 2023, a certain group of people with CMT1A benefited from taking the combination more than others. These include younger patients with no obesity and milder symptoms. In addition, the beneficial effect of the drug might be obvious immediately, but does not improve the condition over a long period of time. It might halt the speedy progression of the disease, but not more than that. And I can actually attest to these conclusions. Having seen Pfanex's data, I started taking the combination back in April 2022, as you can see on this timeline. And I just got the three components. Since they're available on the market, I just bought them. I mixed them up by myself, and I started taking the combination. And I noticed immediate improvements within the first 2 weeks. Subjectively, the heaviness in my legs, which is particularly obvious in the mornings, went away. My feet, especially the left one, got straighter. And the characteristic lateral foot bend to the side got smaller. I also felt that the episodes of fatigue got shorter, my legs felt stronger, and I started doing calf raises, something I actually couldn't do for the last 10 years. I also conducted a 10-meter walk test. This is a secondary endpoint used in the PXT3003 trials, and objectively, my walking speed increased. But my initial happiness from all the improvements was replaced by somewhat of a disappointment when my condition plateaued. As you can see, I've been taking the combination for more than 4 years now. And although the effect is not that obvious anymore, I still think it might be delaying the progression of the disease. So I decided to keep taking it until other treatment options are available. I don't think that the whole PXT3003 situation is as simple as the drug failed, especially given that the initial trial results were very encouraging. Perhaps this drug really works better for certain people, and when it is initially administered, then it might be slowing the disease progression, but mildly. If this is the case, the beneficial effect of the drug might have been lost in the data, which includes elderly patients too. Another reason could have been that the endpoints were chosen incorrectly for these trials. Maybe ONLS is not a sensitive measurement tool, and researchers need to find other, more fine tools, such as blood biomarkers. There could have been several reasons why PXT3003 failed, but unless we have access to the data and dive deep into its analysis, we can only speculate. That's what I'm doing right now. But anyway, I hope someday we can get more answers. And to finish up, I'd also like to discuss the animal data for PXT3003. As you know, clinical trials on people are preceded by animal studies. The drug needs to be shown safe and effective in animal models of the disease first. In case of PXT3003, this was done. But additionally, researchers continued conducting animal studies even when the drug was already in clinical trials. So as you can see here, first, the paper was published in December 2014, which describes a beneficial effect of PXT3003 in two models of CMT1A, mice and rats. Then, in 2019, another paper was published describing how, when administered shortly after birth for a short period of time, PXT3003 delays the onset of symptoms in rats with CMT1A, and this effect is long-lasting. This reminds me that Pharnext also planned a pediatric clinical trial to test PXT3003 in children, but I believe this was never done, even though maybe that's exactly when PXT3003 is most effective. And finally, in 2020, a paper showing that all the components of PXT3003 are needed to achieve a better effect in CMT1A rats. This was achieved not only by inducing myelination, but also by restoring the neuromuscular junction and muscle innervation. That is, PXT3003 supports the axonal function. That's what was shown in the animal study.
So that's it for today. The moral of the PXT3003 story is that even those drugs that are very close to being approved sometimes fail. Whether the reason is the ineffectiveness of the drug, the inappropriate endpoints or selection criteria for the participants, or anything else, we'll likely never know. But as you can see, the drug development process is very long and complex, with many things to be taken into account. I hope that the understanding and acceptance of how complex the process is something that would make you hopeful. There are many other therapeutic approaches being developed, especially for CMT1A, and it's just really the matter of time. And in addition, I hope you won't succumb to conspiracy theories claiming that it is beneficial for many people not to develop drugs for CMT. Who is it really beneficial for? If it's AFO making companies or other companies producing CMT friendly or useful products, they don't have any power over FDA or other agencies that approve drugs. If it's the pharmaceutical companies, it makes even less sense. If there is an effective CMT drug, the companies would benefit from selling it, right? Anyway, leave your comments in the description below about what you think about PXT3003, about this whole story. And I hope this video helped you understand what happened and still made you hopeful about drug development for CMT. Okay, bye-bye.